Gentlemen are making a big mistake.
This here is Mr. Thurgood Marshall. The man is an attorney. You will treat him with the respect that he deserves.
I need a partner who the jury can relate to.
Sam Friedman.
Good to meet you, Sam. Hey, give me a hand with these, would you?
What have you got in here, cement?
Guns. Books, Mr. Friedman.
Can't deny me now. Tunnel vision.
If you want freedom, you're gonna have to fight for it. The only way to get through a bigot's door is to break it down.
Tell me something. What do you know about Wakanda?
It's a third world country. Textiles, shepherds, cool outfits.
All the front. Explorers have searched for it. Called it El Dorado. They looked for it in South America. But it was in Africa the whole time. I'm the only one who's seen it. And made it out alive.
Only play the platters that matter, the matters they platter, and that's the Taruk Root.
Hello everyone, thanks for obliging me with that short video, and thanks for having me here. It's wonderful to be at a gathering about the art of imagination. What a wonderful thing, imagination. Here is a picture of me in college, developing my imagination. And it was while I was in school that I learned about poets and playwrights, and those were the storytellers that ignited the imagination in me. And with their rich stories, I began to learn that there was a medium that I could use for storytelling, and that was theater and film. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the creation of the costumes for Black Panther. So how many of you have heard of Wakanda? Yes, pretty much all of you. Well, I have news for you. There's no plane or train that's going to take you there. There's no way you can visit Wakanda. It was all made up by Jack Kirby and Stan Lee back in the 60s, and through these little boxes, these little comic book strips, you could see that there was this immersive world, this world that told the story about Africa and the first Black superhero. So how did we come together to create this big blockbuster film called The Black Panther? Well, there was a huge manual that was created by Ryan Coogler and Hannah Beekler. Hannah also won the Oscar for production design. And she created a manual, and they had this map of Wakanda. And as you can see, it has the center citadel, it has a Wakanda University, it has the central business district. It has all the same districts that any big city might have. And so within those districts, there are certain tribes that we learn to be inspired. We called them by fictitious names. The Border Tribe was one of them. And there's a whole dossier that we read about these different tribes, but most importantly, they were inspired by real tribes in Africa. So the Border Tribe was inspired by the Lesotho people of South Africa. So Marvel asked, well, what do they look like? Those Lesotho, the Border Tribe inspired by Lesotho. What do they look like? This is Wakanda. It's a forward-thinking nation. Well, we did this illustration, and after we did it, we thought, well, this is very tribal and very traditional, but it doesn't look very forward-thinking. So we did another illustration, and we showed how they would translate their modern style and also honor their traditions. You see that in the center, there's the tribal elder, and behind him is the queen mother. And we did this exercise with all of the tribes. This is how it played out in the film. And the Border Tribe is known for these blankets that I'll tell you about in a minute. Also, there was the merchant tribe, and the merchant tribe was responsible for all the trading in Wakanda. Here's how they looked with their ancient cultural costumes. And then we modernized it so that everybody on my team could share in the visual of what we were going to do, especially as it plays out in the Warrior Falls. Here you see Dorothy, who is the elder of the merchant tribe with her big Fulani earrings, and standing next to her is her fierce warrior. The artisan tribe was also based on the Turkana people of Africa. And you can't look at a beautiful research photo like this and not be inspired to create some more beautiful clothing. So here's how we mixed culture and modern dress together to show everyone, not only on my team, but also at Marvel, what direction we were going with our imagination and with our art. Here is the River Tribe. Our River Tribe was inspired by the Wajanya of Congo and the Sami and the Suri people, and they wore the big lip plates. Now, the lip plates are normally worn by the women. It's a form of beauty. But in our story, we were going to put the lip plate on one of our tribal elders. So here you see our tribal elder standing next to the queen mother of the tribe and some modern ideas that would create this world. Here is Lupita Nyong'o's costume. She was the fierce warrior of the River Tribe. And so we used a lot of beads and shells and leaves because of the green color that we were going to use as our inspiration for everything she wore. Everything that she wore in the film was green. Here's how it played out. At the Warrior Falls, you see the tribal elder, he has his lips plate, he's in his traditional garb, and he's standing next to his fierce warrior, Nakia. The miners, the mining tribe, how many have heard of vibranium? Yeah, it's also fictitious, made up by Jack Kirby and Stan Lee, but it did represent the strongest metal on the earth. And so here they are at the Warrior Falls. You see Connie, the leader of the mining tribe. She's wearing a Himba wig. The Himba hair is used by taking the clay soil and mixing it with shea butter, and they put it on their skin, they put it in their hair. Some people think it's an antiseptic that they use during the time of the drought. Some people say it wards off mosquitoes, but the truth of the matter is they just like the way they look, and it's all about beauty. So what we tried to do is redirect some of our images of beauty to show more than what is normal. Standing next to her is her fierce warrior, and he's based on the Maasai. Because at the Warrior Falls is where all the Wakandans came in their traditional costumes. And on his head, he is wearing a traditional headdress that the Maasai wear. The bigger the headdress, the more fierce the warrior. And this headdress is seen in the comics, but it's seen on one of the tribal elders. And here, our tribal elder is a woman. So we couldn't use this headpiece at tribal council, to my disappointment. And I thought, where can I get that Maasai headdress in? So I decided that once we got to Warrior Falls, we would dress the warrior in this headdress, but we couldn't spend money on it. So what did we do? We went to Pier 1 Imports and we got a beaded placemat. And it was really hard to cut that circle out the middle, I have you know. And then we painted it and we added the feathers and the furs. And, you know, compared to the hundreds of thousands of dollars that we spend on Marvel costumes, this one cost us about 15 bucks. So you have the Citadel, and the Citadel is right in the center of Wakanda, and that's where the royal family, they meet, they live, it's where all of the government is takes place. And here is a picture of the royal family. You have Zuri, the chieftain of Wakanda. He's the spiritual leader. He represents all the tribes. He's unbiased. Next to him is Wakabe. He's the leader of the border tribe. They protect the border, and they are some of Wakanda's most fierce warriors. Above Wakabe is Killmonger. Killmonger is of the Lost Tribe in America. He goes back to Wakanda to avenge his right for ownership to the throne. Below him is Nakia. Nakia is in green, and she is the warrior of the River Tribe. Below Nakia in red is Okoye. She is the leader of the Dora Milaje. The Dora Milaje, which was the fan favorite, and also they protect the king. They are the top grade, most fierce fighting force in Wakanda. Below Okoye is Shuri. That is the Black Panther's little sister. She is the head of the Wakandan design group. Above her is Ramonda, the Queen Mother. Standing next to Ramonda is the Black Panther. Now, the day that we took this photograph, it was an exclusive for Entertainment Weekly. Black Panther hadn't been out. Nobody knew anything about it. And we gathered this group together. And I'm standing kind of like about where I'm standing now, and they're all in the flesh right in front of me. And it hadn't been proven. We just had created this world, this fictitious place. We brought it to life. And on this day, I really felt it. I really felt like we had done something really special we were about to present to the world. And look what it did, $1.3 billion. So let's talk a little bit about my art and my imagination, which is costume design. There we go.
The world is changing. The outside world is catching up. And soon, it will be the conquerors or the conquered.
Now, how do we come up with all of these ideas that you see in that scene? We traveled over River Tribe Elder with his lift plate. We went by Connie, who is the Mining Tribe Elder, with her red, and she had a strip of leather. We traveled around to Killmonger at the throne, and next to him was a Wakabe. Behind them, there were soldiers in the Citadel that spoke no lines, but yet they were a part of the composition of this whole scene. How does that all take place? Well, it's a step-by-step process. Here we have a Wakabe sketch. This sketch is done by the illustrators in my office, and we come up with dozens of illustrations to present to Marvel. Marvel also has a visual development department that works on all of their movies at the same time. And then we have an office of our own that has illustrators in it as well. They're all led by me, the costume designer. I have to gather research. I have to express to them what direction I'd like things to go in. And in this case, it was all based on the African tribes. So here is the Lesotho people of South Africa. Ryan Coogler, who directed The Black Panther, felt that he couldn't direct a film about a place he had never been to. So he went and spent some time with this village, the Lesotho village. And he fell in love with these blankets. So on my first day, Ryan Coogler came to me and he says, we have to figure out a way to put these blankets in the film. And I think I'd like them to be big shields so that on one side we can lace them with vibranium and the other side they'll be just the pattern that you see. They'll wear it over one's shoulder and when they go into battle, they'll whish their arms out and we'll see the vibranium and we'll see the weapons. Easier said than done. So the first thing we did to communicate that was to show the costume in its various phases and to also make sure that we had plenty of places for the weapons to sit and to live. So we came up with this idea based on the Lesotho people who actually they live in a mountainous, cold area, which is why they use the blankets. And they were the folksy kind of look, much different than any of the other costumes that we created for the Black Panther. Then we got the blankets. I imported about 150 blankets from South Africa. There's only one company that makes those colorful blankets. It's called Aranda, and it's in South Africa. We imported 150 blankets, and we got to lacing them with vibranium. Basically, it was a silver foil that we stamped on one side. Then we showed the blankets to Ryan Coogler, and he took a look at it, and he said, I see it's cracked in places, and vibranium doesn't crack. So back we went to try again to actually present something to Ryan that was solid. Once we got the solid idea together, we had what is known as our camera test. The camera test is where all the actors stand in front of the camera and it rolls on them. They turn, they do moves in character, and then that film and that footage goes back to Marvel. Marvel decides whether it's a thumbs up or a thumbs down. So after we did that, we showed the footage to Marvel and they said, the blankets are too thick. They don't drape well. We don't want you to use them. Now I imported, as I said, 150 blankets. No one else makes them. So, you know, I called all the blanket people, Woolwich, and I said, can you make a blanket? I can show you the design. They said, sure we can. It'll take about 6 months. I didn't have that kind of time. I had about 3 weeks. So one of my staff members, Caroline, she said, I'm gonna go buy a men's, you know, shaver, and I'm gonna shave the blanket down. So she, it was a process. About 2 hours later, we had a nice thin blanket, but we had 150 of them. Then my other employee, Paul, he said, I think there's two fibers here. If I torch one side, I think I can get that done in minutes. So I said, Paul, outside. He went outside, he torched it, and he came back in 15 minutes with a nice thin blanket, but it smelled awful. We tried everything to get it out, vodka spray and all the stuff, the tricks that we use in the trade. Nothing would get the smell out. So we shaved all of them. Then we sent this video clip to Marvel. And it was approved. So the Black Panther suit, if you didn't know it, it's called a habit. It's not called a suit, it's called a habit. And the first suit that we had in the Black Panther was the one from Captain America Civil War. This suit what I brought to my office because I wanted to see it up close. And as I look, this video should play all the way down the suit, but it got stuck for some reason. But you can see enough of it. This suit was rather thick and clunky. It wasn't exactly what I had anticipated when I got the Panther suit in my office on a mannequin. It had Velcro in the back and chevrons that were really big and thick, you know, thick rubber like a spare tire. So I thought, not for the Black Panther, no. Maybe I should have Chadwick Boseman come to my office and put it on. That's one way to get Chadwick in your office. So he came in, he put the hat on, he put the suit on, and when he put the helmet on, it was majestic. It really had a bit of a power, and it was just amazing. The Black Panther was in my office, and he was stretching and doing some of his karate moves, and I was in awe. And then he said, yeah, but I can't lift my arm higher than this, and I can't breathe out of my nose either. This helmet is too tight. So I know that in this film, it was a quick job to get him in a Panther suit. They put him in the movie at the last minute. So there were problems that they didn't have time to work out, but we had time. So the first thing we did with Ryan Meiderding of the Marvel development team and Adi Gradov was to take a look at the helmet and streamline it. In the first film, the helmet was gigantic. He was like a bobblehead. And so they thought, we don't want to have to do all that work in post. Let's get a helmet that actually is a streamlined. So there were a lot of decisions made on the helmet. Then they came up with a design. The design was simpler. The line work was very simple, and it was much more tight to the body. No more big clunky chevrons, no big lines anymore. Then we had to look at it front, side, and back. My thought was, this is the king of Wakanda. He's gonna be walking around in this cat suit. I find that a little bit kind of hilarious. But there's gotta be a way I can connect him to the continent and make it make sense. Just make it make sense. He's walking around pretty much in a spandex bodysuit proclaiming he's the king. So also with Killmonger. Killmonger was another cat, the nemesis that was played by Michael B. Jordan, and we had to show him in opposition to the Panther suit. So they designed him with spots, with scarification, and his elements of design were gold. So that's how we could distinguish between the two of them when they're fighting. Also, we had to make some decisions about his claws and his hands because, you know, when these guys are really doing their stunt work in movies, you know, they could really hurt themselves if they have like claws like that. So we also don't want to make them in rubber because they will continuously rip off. So what we decided was that I would design the glove with a channel. And in post-production, Marvel would put the claws in. So that's one way that we work together with the visual effects and costumes. We discuss all of these details. How do you become a superhero? Well, the first thing we have to do is get you a muscle sculpt. And that means we scan your body, we make a mannequin out of you, and then we put clay on top to sculpt your muscles. Because the superhero is a dynamic shape. And so then we have to discuss how dynamic is that shape. Well, Ryan Coogler felt that he wanted Chadwick Boseman to not be as chiseled as Michael B. Jordan. He wanted him to be more human-like. And then we put more striations in the muscle sculpt for Michael B. Jordan. Then there is a vacuform that is created. It's the muscle suit. Every superhero has one. The muscle suit in this case is made out of vibranium, much like the Man of Steel. So I observed other superhero costumes, and I went to Warner Brothers where they have a lot of them stored, and I took a look at the superheroes, and I thought, okay, there is a surface texture, and there's this muscle suit thing. And the Man of Steel, I actually can almost see through the top layer to the Man of Steel, to the steel muscles. So I thought we can do the same thing with the Black Panther, but his muscles will be made out of vibranium and we'll be able to see them through the suit. The other aspect of his suit was how it lit up. The kinetic energy that he's faced with, once he's in battle, his suit lights up in certain areas. So I looked at that line work and I said, I hope that's being done in post because I don't want to make that costume light up, please. And I didn't have to, but I did have to create the line work on the suit. So the line work was discussed and over-discussed. And at first we were going to have the Wakandan language, which is a whole creative alphabet that's created. The Wakandan language was gonna vein up through the suit. And then they said, well, what does it say? And we waited for them to figure out what that Wakandan language would say as it traveled around the suit. That took a month. And then we decided, oh, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, it shouldn't say anything because all of those fans out there would try to figure that out. So we were going to just put the alphabet there. But I looked at that, and in combination with the surface texture. Here you can see it a little bit. There's a little triangle all over the suit. You see a little bit of the veining lines. And together, that triangle and those veining lines created an Ankara fabric, an African tapestry. And the triangle, which is the sacred geometry of Africa, it means the mother, the father, and the child, is the perfect symbol to put on this suit and make that connection. So when he's walking around Wakanda, we actually have a story within his suit, not just a black cat. So here you can see it a little bit better there on his knee and on his chest. We called that the Okavango pattern. Queen Ramonda. Queen Ramonda is the queen of Wakanda, the queen mother. Here you see an Ishikolo. She wears in the comics this hat called the Ishikolo. It means it's the South African married woman's hat. And in the comics, she wears her Ishikolo, she's barefoot, she's got her yoga pants on. She's like the most low-key queen you ever saw. And I thought, well, for our movie, maybe we want to recognize her as the queen. When you see her standing on the landing pad, you know immediately that's the queen. And how should we create this Ishikolo hat? Should we have it hand woven, or would she, as the queen, have some of the best craftspeople, the most advanced, technologically savvy members of Wakanda make her hat? Well, that was my feeling. If I was queen of Wakanda, I would want to have the best. And so we went to Julia Korner of UCLA. She was working with the technology that 3D printed clothing pieces. And she worked with a company that was in Belgium. So she came into my office and we talked over the queen's hat. She went back and she designed these shapes, these spheres, based on a true Ishikolo in the computer. Also, her shoulder mantle was 3D printed. And in these colored diagrams, you see that all of the different pieces that we had to print. And in Belgium, they have a machine, which I'll show you right now, that prints the most flexible, wearable material. That's why we had it done there. And this is how it works. It comes out in a powder cube. already see it's kind of flexible. Sometimes it's broken and they have to start over again. Then they put it in this booth and they spray air on it to get all of the remaining particles off of it. And it becomes this really wonderful, flexible piece. And it's plastic, it's rubber, it's a mix of resin. I don't know what it is, but it works. And these are some of the algorithms that she creates. What's great about it is we can start this process before we know who the actress is, because once we get the actress and we know the size, she just adjusts the numbers, and then we go to printing it. And usually it comes out in just two colors, black or white. And in our case, I didn't want to take it out of the realm of the 3D material that actually was generated from the process by coloring it, because I thought if I sprayed it and we dyed it or we did something to it, it would lose the kind of magic of the 3D printing process. Here is some other, this is Iris Van Erpen. She is a 3D artist, a fashion designer, and she makes clothes. She makes fashion. So our Queen Ramonda wore a crown that was flexible and wearable and perfectly cylindrical. And here's how it looks in our workroom. Here's before it was sprayed. And as you can see in the film, we lightly sprayed it. And then I wore one. And this was also based on African lace. So I really wanted to wear a piece to the Oscars that I felt represented the technology and the things that we had done in the film. So the Dora Milaje. The Dora Milaje is the highest ranking female fighting force of Wakanda, the fan favorite. Everyone wanted to weigh in on who was going to be the illustrator that illustrated the design that we would eventually build. So everyone was excited to come up with their version. This one was illustrated by Anthony Francesco of the Marvel Development Department. And you can see here that in the comics, the Dora Milaje, they were pretty, I like to call it bombastic, you know. You know, they had, you know, the posture and they had the bodies, but comics can get away with all of that because they can move or they can have images of them moving in the comics and everything stays in place. That just doesn't happen in the real world. Also, Ryan Coogler really wanted the Dora Milaje, the women, to be powerful and multidimensional, but also taken seriously. He wanted them to have a uniform, and he wanted that uniform to be practical, in that uniforms cover vital organs. He didn't want them in heels. We put them in split-toe boots. And then we took a look at this illustration, and let me go back. And you can see that the colors that lay out remind you a little bit of the Maasai tribe. So we are only allowed to make, because of budgetary concerns, so many Dora. So I upped the red, I upped the color, because I felt like the red was an imposing color, that when you see one Dora, it feels like three. When you see three, it feels like six. So we made it a little bit brighter. I just fell in love with the Himba tribe and how they use the cattle, the calf skins, and they stretched them and they turned them into clothing. Then we turned that illustration around. You see here the information is skewed because she's standing in three quarter. We had to turn that illustration around forward so that we could look at proportion, and we lowered the tabard. We honored the female form by taking the tabard and the other leather elements and creating a harness effect. The harness effect travels around the female form. We also added some scarification that you can see here. Here in the bust area and the sides area, you see areas of scarification. You also see beadwork, which is also very commonplace in Africa with their artistry, and it's usually something that's handed down. We really wanted this harness to feel like a samurai, like to feel like something that could be handed down to a younger Dora or a daughter. We also put trinkets on the front of each Dora's costume, and each trinket was a little bit different. So some meant good luck, the others meant what tribe they originally came from, because the Dora came from all different tribes, and then their heads were shaven so that they would be unified. So there's one little clue to them by these little trinkets that they wear. We also designed the striations on their costume to go upwards, to not cut the body off, to not be to be more attractive to the female form. And this is how it all turned out. You see that she's wearing neck rings and arm rings, and Ryan Coogler really wanted that to feel like jewelry. So we actually had a jewelry designer do the prototypes, and then we molded them out of rubber. Shuri, the head of the design group, she was the little sister to the Black Panther, and because she worked in a lab, everybody wanted a lab coat, and I kept thinking, there's gotta be a way I get out of this lab coat thing. And so I thought she could have overlays. So I did protective overlays on her costume, where you see she has a mesh overlay over her dress. She has this chiffon overlay over this dress. And that was to represent the protective layers that she would wear in her lab. And I'm almost done here. And so the Dora Milaje at the end, at the UN, you know, in the filmmaking process, some things are spontaneous. It's hard to be spontaneous on a Marvel film because everything has to be to the sketch. But in this case, you see Danai Gurira here, and she called me to her trailer 10 minutes before she was due on set, and this dress had sleeves on it. And she said, I just feel like my arm should be out. So I looked for the design lines that we created in the dress, and I called the seamstress in, and we picked the sleeves off. And 15 minutes later, she was on set. But it was a nice addition to her look. She has incredible arms, and sometimes creating in the moment creates some of the most successful ideas. I'll go quickly through armor. Armor is usually based on other elements, and in this case, we base them on carvings and weaponry in Africa. We also base them, as you see here, the Ndebele woman with her neck rings, which created the neck rings for Danai. We also came up with a panther buckle that was multi-layered and a chest piece for Okoye that was, you know, armor pieces kind of manipulated and moved upside down and put together to create the chest piece that we try out on the computer. We come up with anything and everything. We throw everything against the wall to see how it sticks. These are some of our early designs for the Dora Milaje. They needed a second costume because they would be at the Warrior Falls and there would be water. And their base costume that I showed you is made of leather. And you know, leather and water are just not friends. So we tried to come up with other things that we could use to signify something that they would wear at ceremony. Here you see different armor pieces that are worn. Now all of these are carved out of clay. Molds are made. The molds are pulled, they're rubber, so that they can actually do stunts in them. And then some very talented people paint them to look like wood or metal or macrame. So we have M'Baku, who is the head of the Jabari tribe. If you remember him, he was the guy that said, are you done? Are you done? We are vegetarians. You know, I loved his role from the start. And you see, he has a fur piece. They live in the mountains of Wakanda, and he has a fur piece on his shoulders. And during that same camera test, he walked out in this costume, and that fur piece kept falling down, you know. I'm standing to the side, I'm really embarrassed, and I'm going up with my costumers, and we're pinning it back on, and then it fell again, and then we tried a string, and then the producers are like, is he gonna wear the string in the movie? You know, of course not. And so eventually we found that refrigerator magnets kept it up. And it was really hard to get it off then. But they were based on the Dogon of Mali. The Dogon tribes were some of the first astronomers, and they had these ceremonies that they held once a year, just with these headpieces that shot up into the sky. And so Ryan Coogler loved the grass skirt. So he says, I really want the Jabari tribe in battle to have these grass skirts. And you know, the producers are scratching their heads again, and I'm loving it. So we found a photo of one that we liked, and we based his costume on that photo, and then we sent this image to Marvel. And it was approved. Here's how it played out in the film. And it really showed, when they come into the scene and they're a surprise, it really does feel like they came from a way off, far away place. So as we went on this journey, I showed you how we took elements of culture and we made it into a superhero. Let me go back. We took these elements of cultures and we created a superhero film. So I'm asked all the time about my experience at Marvel, you know, how it felt to design your first superhero, and I always say the same thing. All my career, I have been designing superheroes. Malcolm X was a superhero. The people of the Amistad were superheroes. There were superheroes in Roots. And many other of my films, including The Black Panther, which I won for last year. So thank you.